गुड इवनिंग फ्रेंड्स, वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस दिस इवनिंग पेरी ऑपरेटिव कॉम्प्लिकेशंस फॉलोइंग मेजर सर्जिकल प्रोसीजर्स। व्हेन आई से पेरी ऑपरेटिव, वी विल डिस्कस प्री ऑपरेटिव, इंट्रा ऑपरेटिव एंड पोस्ट ऑपरेटिव मैनेजमेंट फॉर सच सिचुएशंस। पल्मोनरी कॉम्प्लिकेशंस आर मच मोर कॉमनर देन कार्डियक कॉम्प्लिकेशंस। I want to raise three points. Pulmonary complications are much more commoner. Number one, there are lot of modifications which we can do in pulmonary complications to prevent them or to minimize them for their early detection and early management. And the pulmonary complications are varying from just increase in secretions of bronchial tree, superadded chest infection, increased cough, pulmonary infiltrates to pneumonia, atelectasis and acute pulmonary edema, acute lung injury and eventually acute respiratory failure. And ARDS. So if I repeat, the spectrum of pulmonary complication start from increased pulmonary secretions, bronchial secretions, superadded infection, pneumonia, atelectasis, acute lung injury, ARDS and acute respiratory failure. This is the wide spectrum. Now, the incidence ranges from 2 to 40% of the surgical procedures. Now, another important factor I want to highlight is that patients who develop lung complications following major general surgery ...20% patients die within 30 days. 20% patients following major general surgical procedures would die within 1 month. And every third patient who develops lung complications following major GI surgery like Whipple's, esophagectomy, gastrectomy, liver resection, liver transplant, every third patient will die if he develops respiratory failure in post-operative period. Now, that is the impact which can really change the outcome, which can also increase the mortality after well-done surgery. So, let us try to analyze what are the risk factors. Now, the risk factors are classified into two situations. One, the procedure related risk factors. Now, what procedures produce more complications? Now, the first point is surgical site related complications. Surgical site related complication is incisions on the upper abdomen, on the thorax, are more likely to lead to lung complications. The duration, let us not forget two more issues, neurosurgery and operations on head and neck, plastic surgery, cleft palate are also more prone to lung complications. Duration of surgery, any procedure which takes more than 2 hours is likely to have more lung complications. The type of anesthesia, the neuroaxial anesthesia, in other words, spinal or epidural, has lesser pulmonary complications than general anesthesia. Now, these are few procedure related complications and factors which lead to complications. Now, let us discuss what are the patient related complications. The commonest situation is smoking. Cigarette smoking is the commonest risk factor which leads to lung complications, and it is the duty of clinician that for all elective surgeries, we stop, convince the patient to stop smoking at least 8 weeks before surgery. The maximum benefit comes 8 weeks before surgery. And there was a previous concept that if somebody stops smoking for 24 hours or 48 hours, there is rebound phenomenon. There is no rebound as on today. So one can go ahead even if an emergency surgery, you have a bowel obstruction admitted today, you're going to operate him after 24 hours or 48 hours, you again stop the smoking maybe for 48 hours. Even that would help, not to the magnitude of 8 weeks stopping of cigarettes. Now, next important point is COPD. Now, we have a lot of smoker population and a lot of COPD patients who come for elective surgery. Now, the 2 points I want to say. COPD, which is well compensated. When I say well compensated means, number one, there is no superadded infection. Number two, the spasm is under control. Number three, it is not associated with pulmonary hypertension. Number four, it is not associated with core pulmonary. When we get a COPD patient, we need to rule out 4 things. Remember, the respiratory problems. If the patient has more symptoms in COPD, there can be only 3 things. As far as surgeons are concerned, we should know some basic medicine. And the answer comes, what deteriorates a patient with COPD? A patient who was stable has become breathlessness. Quickly think of 3 things. Superadded infection, number one. Right heart failure, number two. And pneumothorax, number three. Even a small pneumothorax can make the patient breathlessness in a patient who was previously compensated. So the COPD should be optimized by preoperative control of infection, ruling out pulmonary hypertension, pneumothorax, and given appropriate antibiotics if the culture is positive. The bronchodilations should be done in an optimal dose, and if the patient is steroid dependent, the steroid should be converted from oral to intravenous for the perioperative period, and a low dose steroid does not produce any ill effects. So these are few pulmonary complications as related to COPD. Then the 2 more conditions, bronchial asthma and interstitial lung disease, ILD. They do not make any effect in the outcome if they are controlled. Pulmonary hypertension, if present, increases the risk. Now, obstructive spleen, obstructive sleep apnea is another important issue. We must try to find out in all people who are predisposed to obstructive sleep apnea to find out, treat and manage that beforehand. Post-operatively picked up when a patient worsens, and if we then realize the patient has obstructive sleep apnea, then that increases the mortality and morbidity, and that time it doesn't help. Now, 2 more things. We need to remember 3 solid facts. All these things are plus minus, but there are 3 patient factors which are universally accepted statistically to make difference in the outcome. Number one, cigarette smoking. Number two, complications of COPD. Number three, age more than 60. And number four, the nutrition of the patient. Nutrition is an important precursor of thoracic complications following any major non-thoracic surgery. Now, the cutoff point is 3.5 serum albumin. Those people who to begin with have got lower albumin are more likely to have lung complications. But remember, if somebody has low albumin and you try to correct it, the correction does not decrease the incidence of complication. I repeat, low albumin has higher risk of lung complications. But if you rectify the low albumin, it doesn't decrease the chances of complications. Now, as far as clinical examination is concerned, routine history should include one important fact which I want to highlight, that we should check into performance status. Actually, at a resident level, I would insist everybody gets into the, when he writes the history or tell the examiner, he should mention, sir, the performance status is grade 1, grade 2, grade 3. Then that way you can drag the examiner to an area which you know. Then what will be the next question of the examiner, whoever it may be, the examiner? When you say, sir, the performance is grade 2, obviously the next question is going to be, what is the grading of performance status? That all of you should know as a resident level. And the famous example which I gave, the hurried evaluation by the internist or anesthetist would ask the patient, aapko saans to nahi chadta? Patient said no. But when they realize on the table, the somebody said, get a lung function done, which were grossly deranged. Now, one point which was not asked, have you ever walked? The Lalaji said, never. I from my chair, I sit into the car, and from car back to the bed. So this fellow who doesn't walk, who doesn't run, who doesn't do exercise, what can be his performance status? Nil. So if he is not breathless, it doesn't give me any message. Broadly, if you ask a patient if he can go 2 flights of stairs up without being breathlessness, without having palpitation, that means his performance status is okay to undergo a lap cholecystectomy. Or somebody who can walk a kilometer at a stretch is also adequate to say that his lung functions are good. On clinical examination, besides the routine findings in the chest, it is good to note the AP diameter of the chest, which is a good predictor of COPD and associated sounds. History of smoking in detail should be taken. The laryngeal height, when it is less than 4 cm, it is associated with higher complication. Now, one very important bedside test which I would like to share, which I have practiced in my life, is which I call as a cough test. You ask the patient to cough. You know, you cough first. Like I would ask the patient, khansi karke dikhao, aise karke dikhao. When you cough once, you don't cough again. But when a patient, if you ask him to cough, and if instead of once he continues to cough, that is a bad patient, a bedside test. Then some of the investigations like PFT, they are not relevant in every patient. It is all right in a non-COPD patient to see what function can be restored by giving bronchodilators. And a baseline pulmonary function test is also required. In a patient who is otherwise healthy, his chest x-ray is okay, but he is breathless. When his breathlessness, in other words, it is not explainable by other factors. Blood gas examination has no value in general population, but it may help in preoperative pulmonary evaluation if the patient is going to undergo upper abdominal surgery. To find out in a COPD upper abdominal surgery, to find out what is the respiratory status, is the patient compensating enough? Routine chest x-ray we all continue to do even before a hernia, before a hydrocele. That is all irrelevant, illogical. If a patient, his respiratory rate is 16, he is otherwise healthy, his saturation is 98 on room air, he is comfortable, he doesn't have any pulmonary symptoms, on auscultation he has no added sounds. Now this is a patient who does not require a chest x-ray. But we have to grow up, mature up, spend some time with the patient to conclude that he is a perfectly normal person. serum albumin is one test if somebody has to do an evaluation of the patient's nutritional status. Now, while we are evaluating the risks of such patients, there is a very important risk stratification. This is being done by a scoring system which is called ARISCAT scoring system. Now, ARISCAT system stands for Assess Respiratory Risk in Surgical Patients. Now, it is based on a calculation system. I do not expect you to remember the details of ARISCAT system, but if you can remember that age more than the criteria, it has got seven criteria in it: age, saturation at room air, the history of respiratory infection in last 3 months, hemoglobin, and the incision, whether the patient is having a upper abdominal incision, thoracic incision. You see, if I try to compare the lung complications following bilateral knee replacement, is much less than cholecystectomy for two reasons. A, cholecystectomy is a upper abdominal incision, open cholecystectomy. B, it is done under GA. Now, there are two factors prevailing in benefit of bilateral knee replacement, because it is a limb surgery. Number two, it is done under neuroaxial block. So both ways the patient gets benefit. Other than incision is the duration of surgery. The duration more than 2 hours has more risk. Then emergency surgery has got more risk. Why more risk in emergency? Because you have not had time, A, to stop smoking, B, to control COPD, C, to control lung infections, D, to have incentive spirometry, which we are going to come next, that how can we prevent these complications. Now, what is the treatment? What are the factors in the treatment which are modifiable on the patient-related risk factor? So, as I said, in emergency, the same are the features. Number one, you control the cigarette smoking at least 2 months before. Now, this may require psychological support, pharmacological support. This is a separate topic to discuss how you help a smoker. I believe all peripheral surgeons should know how to manage their smokers, because until I'm speaking something personal, but it has a meaning. As my boss used to say, Dr. Eggleston used to say, if you are not married to a physician, you need to know some internal medicine, at least for the MBBS level. So it has been shown by Mayo Clinic, 8 weeks cigarette smoking cessation has the best benefit role. But even if it is less, don't be worried about rebound. Now, COPD, as I said, should be optimized by bronchodilators, infection control, and steroids if deemed necessary. Now, procedure related risk factor, how can we modify? The procedure related are, number one, whatever can be done under open procedure, if it can be done under laparoscopic surgery, the lung complications are much less. Then, what can be done under regional block also decreases the risk of lung complications. Postoperatively, to decrease lung complication, we have lung expansion maneuvers. In intensive pre-op training of incentive spirometry, the patient should not be taken for any elective surgery till he cannot lift up 3 balls of incentive spirometry one way and 2 the other way. Now, until the patient has not been practiced beforehand, he will never do post-op. For principle, I would like to share, when I see a patient for a major surgery, first time in OPD, I ask the patient to purchase and we train him for incentive spirometry. The surgery may be done after 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, but the person, when he comes in my outdoor, or for that matter, all standard OPDs, should have a PSE room. Unfortunately, I have purposely selected this lecture meant for young surgeons and elderly surgeons of my age who are in a peripheral district practice where there is no PSE culture. The anesthesiologist walks in the theater to do the case. So some basic preoperative workup has to be done by the surgeon himself. And that is the situation where incentive spirometry and looking into all these factors should be done by the surgeon. The second post-op lung expansion factor which we have is non-invasive ventilation. Now, non-invasive ventilation lead to recruitment of more alveoli, prevents alveolar collapse, keeps the patient's respiratory effort low, and prevents the complication, and not totally prevents, but the incidence is decreased. Post-operative analgesia is single important factor because the pain leads to splinting of the chest, and if the patient is given strong opioids, then it leads to decrease in cough reflex and the secretions pool up inside, and that leads to also supurated chest infection. Hence, what is important? All patients should have, if possible, an epidural, even if the patient is done under general anesthesia, for analgesia purpose. If the epidural is not given, then the patient should have tap block right before the skin incision is made. After the tube is put in, the patient gets tap block, post-op cuffs, brings out the secretions, and the lung complications are low. There is a strong recommendation by American College of Chest Physicians on selective use of nasogastric tube. Nasogastric tube also increases A, chest infection, B, the risk of aspiration, because when there is an NG tube in, the cardia remains open and the patient is more likely to aspirate. And the last point, all patients who have the risk of developing DVT. Now that I would like, one of the next topic we will discuss one evening is deep vein thrombosis for general surgeons. Now we need to identify all those patients who are intermediate or high risk to develop DVT. And two things, A, preoperative cough exercises to be taught to the patient, a DVT pump to be used during surgery and post-op, and heparin prophylaxis as and where needed. So DVT prophylaxis is part of the treatment for prevention of lung complications. So far I have discussed is what can be done preoperatively and what can be done postoperatively. I have told so far the risk factors, the mortality and morbidity. It is higher for my GI friends, and it's more important for them because one of the Whipples develops serious lung complications. There is 1/3 chance that guy will die after an excellently done Whipple by the top GI surgeon. So this topic involves not only general surgeons, it also involves GI surgeons to be aware of all those small factors. because the best job well done would be undone if the lung things are not taken care of. And there's nobody more important than the chief surgeon himself to look to it that everything is being done either by his team or by anesthesiology team or critical care team. Now, let me switch on and dwell for 2 minutes. What are the intraoperative methodologies to prevent lung complications? So, we have 2 important things. Number one, ventilating the patient with lesser tidal volume. This is called the lung protecting methodology to prevent the decrease the incidence of lung complications. We ventilate such patients with 6 to 8 ml per kg, whereas the normal requirement may be 10 cc per kg of the patient's weight. So we ventilate them with lesser tidal volume. Number two, the use of PEEP. Now PEEP has the similar value by keeping the alveoli open and to prevent collapse, atelectasis and superadded infection. Now there has been studies on PEEP to compare the PEEP between 12 and 2. That means the high and low. And the net result is that the higher PEEP does not give any additional benefit. So thereby a PEEP of 2-3 centimeters can give equal benefit as higher PEEP. So it is a combination of, and some of the papers say that PEEP, if one has to select one thing between the low volume or the PEEP, PEEP has got more beneficial effects than low volume. But ideally we should do both. We should do PEEP as well as low volume. So this is all about complications, and if there are any questions, I would like to answer. We have a lot of faculty with us. Though I have an obsession to prevent pulmonary complications, but I am not the best guy to guide on pulmonary complications. So we have a lot of bright faculty who would be willing to answer your queries. And whatever little bit I know, I'm there to help you. In the end, I would like to say, all those young surgeons who want to read more about this, the best of the material and the simplistic material is from Washington Manual of Medical Therapeutics and Cardiorespiratory Complications in GI Surgery by Professor Nandi, the book we reviewed last year when it was released. So that is also an excellent book, and 4-5 pages on Professor Nandi's book summarize most of things, whereas Washington Manual gives the other part of the spectrum of the topic. So the youngsters who want to prepare it as a question for exam can consult both books. Thank you very much. Have a nice week ahead.